Thank you, Amanda, and good morning, everyone. As Amanda said, I'm Ryan Owens. I'm the Executive Director of the Manhattan Conservancy and Secretary of the New Hampshire Land Trust Coalition Board. And it is my great, great honor and privilege to introduce this morning's keynote speaker, Peter Forbes. Now, I'm not going to introduce Peter by reciting his resume, though for the sake of credibility, you all ought to know that he's probably in his day done more land deals than most anyone in this room. But that's not exactly why he's here today. Instead, I want to introduce Peter by sharing how my acquaintance with him and with his work have made these past 6 years some of the most transformative of my personal and professional life. And why I believe that it is so very timely that he is addressing us here today. Now, my first encounter with Peter was in 2008, when I found him in the upper left-hand drawer of the big steel desk that I inherited from Dick Over, my predecessor. I was the new executive director of the Manhattan Conservancy, and I was just settling into my new office. And in that drawer, I found a CD of recorded conversations. And on the cover of the CD were photos of people, mostly wearing loose-fitting clothing, sitting cross-legged in a circle in a yurt. And one of them was Peter. And my first reaction, honestly, was, oh, great. Here we go again. Another instance of people talking together about their feelings. And unfortunately, at the time, I dismissed the recording and closed the drawer. And it sat there for a long time. But little was I to know that 2 years later, I would be sitting in a circle in that very same yurt with Peter and about a dozen other young conservation professionals. It's experiencing some of the most powerful emotions my work in land conservation has ever caused me to feel. The place was, and is, the Center for Whole Communities at Knoll Farm, perched high above the Mad River Valley in Vermont, an institution co-founded by Peter and where he still often teaches and where he lives. I was there for a retreat for young conservation professionals called 2042 Today, a curriculum envisioned, written, and largely delivered by Peter, among others. And the name of that program comes from the year when demographers predict that the demographic scales will tip, and when today's majorities will become minorities and vice versa. And that's significant not only from a demographic perspective, but for land conservationists, I think it's significant because it will be the time when the constituency, frankly, that is always identified with the tried and true old rationale for land conservation will become a smaller and smaller fraction of the overall population. And we were there as young conservation professionals to figure out how we and our institutions were going to adapt. The experience was both profoundly unsettling and inspiring. So to better reflect the American population, the group was engineered to be highly diverse. So every skin color, every ethnicity, every sexual orientation, every socioeconomic class, urban to rural, Ivy League to GED, was represented in the group. And the first thing I learned from this assemblage of people was that there is still a tremendous amount of pain and suffering in this country. A lot of it having been experienced by the same people around me and by their families and communities, and even some of it perpetrated, however unwittingly, in the name of conservation. And this was what unsettled me. The work I was doing to conserve nature suddenly felt so very trivial in the face of so much injustice. But then I remembered that each of those people there with me were practitioners of conservation, and they were doing that not to escape suffering, but in fact to combat it. And like that, despair turned to inspiration for me. Now, about 5 years ago, Lou Feldstein, who was then president of the New Hampshire Charitable Foundation, addressed this very same conference, giving the keynote address. And it was an address that, honestly, for many of us, left us scratching our heads. I don't know how many people were here, but I think that was true. He said, to sum it up, that we were so damn good at what we do, one of the most successful nonprofit fields in the state. We were so good, too good, in fact, not to extend the skills and the material and spiritual benefits of the places we've conserved to the greater universe of human needs. And I believe we didn't entirely understand what Lou was getting at, because perhaps he was a little bit ahead of his time. And think about it ever since that day. Think about the land trusts and the projects and the programs that are getting the attention and the headlines and the attention from the Land Trust Alliance. They're the people and the places and the projects using open space to grow healthful food, not just for everybody, but specifically for the people who need it most. They're using open space to provide jobs to those who need work. They're using open space to coax kids outdoors who need healthful activity. And they're giving a clean antidote to the addicted or to the depressed. And today the land conservation movement stands on the threshold, I believe, of a momentous transformation. One that, if navigated properly, promises to magnify the service of our work to so much more of humanity, and in so doing, ensure its permanence for generations. One that is not only ethically right, but is also pragmatic. For if the moment is allowed to pass, we risk all that we've done collapsing under the own weight of its own irrelevance. And this will not be easy. It will undoubtedly require forming alliances and making compromises and embracing land uses that perhaps we once considered distasteful. We'll probably also struggle to know where to begin. But fortunately, that's where Peter comes in. The transformation actually is already beginning all around us. Peter Forbes is a teacher, a writer, a father, a farmer, a photographer, and a wood carver. But more than anything, Peter is a collector and teller of stories, and I'm certain that he will share many today. So I invite you to listen with an open mind and an open heart. I invite you to be perhaps just a little bit unsettled, as I was, if only for the novelty of seeing something a little bit differently. And most importantly, I invite you to be inspired by what is already happening around you, and in fact, what you can do too. Peter?
Did you just ask them all to sit? Please, will you all sit? Good morning, folks. Listen, the most, can I get away without a mic, you think?
No.
No. All right, is that better? I feel like we're improving. Ryan, don't go too far.
Okay.
Thank you, right there. Don't leave me, man. The most important thing, as everyone is settling in, that I could possibly say to you right now is to get out of your way. And to say that if 100 years from now, if 150 years from now, there are places where kids can play, there are black bear and fisher cat, there are swimming holes where kids can enjoy themselves, wild places, if there's still towns with rural character and rural characters, it'll be because of what you do. It'll be because of what you do. So first and foremost, I want to thank you for that. How many of you carve spoons? There are some spoon carvers here. Excellent, excellent. This is one of the many ways that I connect back to the land. I could never improve on this cherry tree There's no way. But with a tiny bit of skill and a little bit of intention, I can make something really beautiful and useful from it. And that experience has really transformed my life. And so Ryan, I want to give this spoon to you, my friend, with great gratitude for all you're doing in your neck of the woods to transform the practice of conservation. I also want to introduce you all to this guy, William Copperthwaite, for a variety of reasons. Bill Copperthwaite, number one, is the man who taught me how to carve a spoon. But I also think he taught me a tremendous amount about land conservation. Bill is from Maine, and I should say that another reason I'm having him up there is because Bill passed away in a car accident right before Thanksgiving of last year. He was the first in his family to go to college. This would have been before the Korean War. All of his family members were married to military people. He scored a perfect 500 on the Annapolis Naval Reserve test. This is on the eve of the Korean War, and he turned down a free ride to Annapolis because he didn't believe in the war that was coming up. And what I want to do is read to you for a moment from a letter that Bill wrote to his sister in 1954. Excuse me, I'm going to pick the glasses. It's another thing that's happened since the last 12 years when I was here. Take this in if you would. Dear Viv, this is a hard letter to write, but I'm going to do my best. You seem to feel that I am acting rashly and without having thought this through. Believe me, this is not the case. My duty in this situation has been considered and thought on almost constantly for many, many months. More thought has gone into this decision than any other in my life. So it hurts to have you, who understands me better than most, to think that I have acted irresponsibly. Some think this is a position of cowardice. I do not think you feel I am a coward, for it is a much more difficult thing to do what you feel is right when your family and friends do not understand and believe you are acting wrongly than it is to go as a soldier. Most strongly, you feel that I have been selfish, holding to my ideals when they cause pain to mom and others. You may be right. But I have thought about this a great deal. This thought has bothered me more than any other. I cannot bring myself to feel that Mom would want me to do what I believe to be wrong, dishonest, or unjust. To do so would be to negate all that she has done and taught me. That she does not understand what I am doing is painful to her as it is to me. In due reverence to her, I cannot do other than what I believe to be right and good. I want to share that with you because of this really important question, I think, that arises in all of us. What do we care about enough today to take such a stand? You know, my answer to that personally is this. I mean, not dolphins and whales specifically, but what that symbolizes. I mean, the great diversity of life. All the parts of it, all the things with whom we share this earth. This diversity of life is what shapes us, makes us who we are. This diversity of life, I feel, is our true wealth. And this is also what I take a stand for. And this is what I believe you also take a stand for. So for a moment, if I could, I want to ask you to put aside every nice thing that Ryan said and consider these things that I stand for. This is also who I am. Bull Run Farm, Sage's Ravine, Spruce Knob, Dickinson's Reach, Heron's Rip, Moosalot, absolutely Moosalot, Arun River Valley, Central Harlem, Cedar Mesa, Chama River, Arch Rock, Drake's Beach, Lake Atitlan, and Knoll Farm. So that's me. That's who really I am. Those words, those places, they tell my story better than any other. They're the waters, the food, the wood, the dreams, the memories that literally make up this guy in front of you. I'm that alchemy of land and people and story. But this is also my story. And it's one that I've only recently been able to speak of. I am also the youngest son of a Jewish immigrant who came here from poverty and a city in the Ukraine. He arrived here with a different name and a different language, and this was his first experience of America. One of the few things I have of his possessions, this 8mm film of what it was like pulling into the East River in New York City sometime around 1938. And yet, his experience of being an immigrant here in this country gave me this powerful, powerful experience and love of the wild. So I am forever, forever privileged by all that he had to do himself to give me this home in America and this love of land. So his legacy makes it really impossible for me to think about place, but also thinking about place for whom, right? I mean, place for whom? And I can't think about that question without thinking about this word. How many of you know this word? It's, for those of you who can't say, querencia. I'd be interested, just show of hands if you've heard this word. This is a very important word for you all to be with. It's a mestizo word, which means it comes from that culture that originated in North Africa and mixed with Jewish culture and actually arrived in northwestern Mexico and southwestern United States. It was defined for me by the cultural anthropologist Esteban Arellano. So, querencia, this one word, means the place where the animal lives. That's easy enough to get, right? It also means the tendency of humans to return to where they were born. Now it gets better, more interesting. It also means affection and responsibility, the space where one feels most secure, the place of one's memories. This one word means also the tendency to love and be loved. So this one word, and many others like it in other languages, Hawaiian, the word kuleani refers to, it's the root, literally the root of the taro plant, which is their staple, but it also means interchangeably community and responsibility. It's wild. These words, they all suggest that our affection and responsibility to one another and to community has always been intimately connected to our relationship to place. And so this too, absolutely, is what I stand for. Querencia doesn't exist for just some people. It doesn't exist just for conservationists, for sure. It exists for all people. The land and nature welcomes bankers and farmers and people in business suits and people in torn car hearts. The land doesn't care if you're young or old or brown or white. Our biology is hardwired to it, and you know that. And to care about the land is not Republican, and it is not Democrat, it is not conservative, and it is not radical. The care is not reserved for environmentalists or even for conservationists. The care is simply human. That's what I take a stand for. So that interconnectedness between that, you know, love of nature, and this, respect of each other, I think is the most important, and I would say least understood story of our conservation movement. How many of you guys recognize this fellow? Yeah, it's Aldo, right? The guy with the binoculars there is Aldo Leopold, extraordinary man, died 1949 at the age of 61, long before his work could really be understood. When I was in college, there were three books I read. Living the Good Life by Helen Nearing, who introduced me to Bill Copperthwaite, and The Unsettling of America by Wendell Berry, and then there was The Sand County Almanac by Aldo Leopold. One of the fathers of our modern conservation movement, and he's the guy who really understood the health of land and the health of people. This man was part biologist and part sociologist at a time when that was totally unacceptable thing to do. And he died much too early to really explain what that means to us. This is what it adds up to. I mean, this is his grand idea, his central idea. He saw one system, people and nature together, the health of one being directly connected to the health of and well-being of the other. Now, part of that, everyone in this room totally gets. I know you do. You know, people need nature as a healthy habitat, right? You know, we need healthy forests, we need healthy oceans. Richard Louv taught us a long time ago that we need that to have healthy kids, right? We got that one down. But the other part of what he's saying is really difficult and provocative. And it's, I think, the more important part of what he was saying. When we are disconnected from nature, we're going to hurt ourselves and hurt nature itself. Because we're the keystone species, we're the dominant dog, when we are disconnected from this whole, it's not just bad for us, it's bad for the entire system. This is how we hurt ourselves. We become greedy, we become fearful of the other, we become forgetful of reality, we become susceptible to spells, lies, and myths, and we always hurt ourselves when that happens, as much as we hurt the land. Every time. When we're fearful of each other and we put up walls between ourselves, like the triple wall that's going up right now between Mexico and this country, or the 50-foot high wall between Israel and Palestine, nations suffer, but the land suffers as well. And when we oppress each other, we always feel licensed to oppress the land. And when we're at war, you know this, nature dies too. So in a much, much less dramatic and everyday sense, the more we are disconnected to nature, the more, you know, we are tuned into things like this, right? The more we struggle to find meaning in things like consumption, false idols, all of that. And then we lie to ourselves and say, you know, none of that really matters. So what I want to say is I don't think there is any sign or law that is big enough or strong enough that's going to stop people who don't care from hurting what they don't know. So it's the caring part, really, the caring part that we have to focus on. How do we help and encourage a great diversity of New Hampshire folks to care about this land? We have to help them feel like they belong, that they're welcome here. And I definitely stand for that as well. And don't get me wrong, I am not a simpleton, you know, advocating thou shalt not post your land or love thy neighbor. You know, you can't always love your neighbor. I don't always love my neighbor. And sometimes land ought to be posted no trespassing, no joke. But what I'm trying to say is that our relationship to nature and place ought to be more like a marriage. You know, a few marriages that exist on paper alone last very long, right? Take that in. Now, my marriage has long, long moments of love, and it has long moments of misunderstanding and hurt. But I'm committed to it for the long haul. And I want us to be committed to the relationship between people and land also for the long haul. And I want to tell you a story about this. Do you remember Michael Pollan, the writer? You know, unbelievably successful nature writer. Like 365 weeks on the New York Times bestseller list. Long before he wrote those books, he wrote a book called Second Nature. It's up there with Alvin Leopold's Sand County Almanac. It's a really good book. But even before then, he was on the editorial board of the New York Times in 2000 when they set out to create a time capsule, right? So do you remember the New York Times did that? It was to be a 1,000-year time capsule. And they brought together all the best minds that they could find to say what should go in this time capsule. And lots of conservationists contributed ideas to that. But then the hard question was, what do we do with this time capsule? I mean, where do we put it? How do we protect it for a 1,000 years, you know? Do they bury it in the ground like a dog bone? I mean, past time capsules, that's what we did with them. We buried them in the ground. Then they went on to, well, do we create a law from Congress that legislates future generations to protect it into perpetuity? And then they said, maybe what we ought to do is raise a ton of money to endow 20 generations of stewards to stand guard beside this time capsule and check on it every few years or so. Does that mean to sound familiar? So the New York Times, of all of its lofty intelligence, considered all of these and discounted each one of them. They said none of those are sufficient to protect something for 1,000 years. So finally, someone asked, or Michael, maybe he himself posed the question, what is around today that was here 1,000 years before? And what was the answer? What was the answer?
Redwood trees.
Redwood trees, yep. Parts of nature, for sure. What else?
Redwood.
Yeah. So there are some creations of mankind, forms of art mostly, that have survived 1,000 years. The only other thing is the Catholic Church that had been around. Now, the New York Times, being the New York Times, did not want to create a church. So what they set out to do was to create the most beautiful object they could. They did an international competition. They created the most beautiful sculpture, and they placed it right on Fifth Avenue in front of the Museum of Modern Art. They put a tiny little plaque, I've walked past this 20 times, little plaque at the bottom that says, open in the year 3000. They encouraged kids to play on it. They encouraged dogs to lift their legs on it. The best way to protect something for 1,000 years is to help people feel connected to it, to help people belong to it, to love it. And I don't think I'm being naive, and I don't think the New York Times is being naive. I know what the problem is, and I know actually who's responsible too. We humans have transformed between a third and a half of the entire Earth's surface. And most of the world's major rivers have now been dammed. A quarter of all mammals are headed to extinction. Climate change, where I am, is moving tree species north at 8 feet per hour. So I know that. I'm still asking the question, how are we going to make this profound work of conservation last 1,000 years? Do you believe that what will make it last 1,000 years is laws alone? I don't. I think our laws alone are not sufficient. I believe what's going to protect into the distant future what I value today is our efforts to help future generations to connect to what we love in their own way. So what will help us to get to perpetuity is not so much laws, but relationships. And this is the simple truth. Future generations, as Ryan said, they're not going to look like us or think like us. And that's okay. It's really the only way it could be. I want to involve them, welcome them, trust them, not simply try to write a damn tight conservation easement that they can't get out of. If over the next two decades we can put our greatest energies into connecting people to this landscape through how they live, work, and play, then I'm incredibly excited about passing the baton to someone I don't even know and who won't look like me. And I want to say to her, I trust you that you will care for this as I've tried to care for it. And I know that's incredibly scary. It's incredibly scary because it's out of our control. But it's unbelievably exciting too, because there are successful efforts doing this, just this, all over our country, and here in New Hampshire too. I called it for a while the shift between conservation 1.0 and 2.0. And I don't think that's really even accurate anymore. That implies one was better than the other. This is really a natural life cycle of our movement, of us becoming larger public citizens. 25 and 30 years ago, most innovative land trusts were working on protecting iconic scenery and biodiversity, and that was incredibly important. And now the most innovative land trusts are focusing their conservation on sustaining livelihoods, on increasing public health, on integrating and strengthening food systems, and how we educate our children. And I want to say that I lived in New Hampshire for 18 years, and I do know it is the center of the universe. And yet I moved from New Hampshire and I had to do some research, and this is what I found out. Actually, we are not in the center of the universe. New Hampshire is right about here. And that was devastating. If I'm the first to share this with you, I apologize. Even worse, we are not in the center of the earth. We are right up here. And the part that floored me, I discovered this last night, we're not even in the center of our country. So, as sad as that was for me, I also found it liberating, because it allowed me to look beyond New Hampshire, everywhere except Vermont, because we all know Vermont is different, to find, you know, some examples of what's really, really going on. And I want to share those with you, because this has given me more hope than almost anything else. So imagine that there's a land trust that does all the traditional conservation work that you're familiar with, but it owns and operates a 400-acre working farm, which feeds year-round 700 families, and it takes food stamps for a third of those families. And that farm is responsible for growing the land trust membership by 300% over the last decade. Those families, they're going to take a stand for conservation. Imagine there's another land trust that gets 25% of its $1.2 million operating budget from a group of hospitals who believe that its recreational trails and public programming are quite literally medicine for their patients. Those patients, they're going to take a stand for conservation. Imagine there's a land trust with such a strong public vision for the use of their land that it's designated by the public school as the lead community partner in helping to educate the young and the old. Imagine there's a land trust in a city that operates 30 community gardens. That's no big deal. We've been doing that for a while. But 50 units of equity-capped housing, and is part owner of a food hub that distributes 200 tons of organic produce from the suburbs to families and restaurants in the core of the city. Imagine there's a land trust that's created something completely new. They call it not a conservation easement, but a cultural easement over some of their land, and they've granted this to a Native American tribe who's going to have legal rights for the first time under a Western system of law to have access to a place that's had enormous physical and spiritual importance to them. Imagine there's a land trust that really understands why some in their community might think that they're elitist. And in response, they bundle up portions of their conserved timberlands and sell them to cooperatives of low-income people who need the firewood, but they also need the benefits of land ownership. Imagine there's a group of land trusts who pool their money and their smarts to conserve 20,000 acres, but simultaneously co-creating with the community something that they call a rural recovery plan that includes endowing a local school, does job training, creates a small business loan fund. So, you know the punchline, right? You know, you don't have to imagine any of that. All of it's real, all of it is happening. This is land trusts becoming larger public citizens. And when you own or control 30% of the state of New Hampshire, as you do here, of course the public expects you to have an opinion on how they're going to heat their home, how they're going to feed their children, how they're going to get to work every day. Because of your success, it's obvious that they would ask you to be a caring public citizen. Imagine these possibilities here in New Hampshire. Imagine a 9-year-old boy in elementary school who walks up to the milk dispenser in the cafeteria and Paul pours into his glass milk from his own family farm. Imagine if all the public schools in New Hampshire were serving locally grown food and heated by local wood, that you'd map your forest to know how you could heat half of the homes in this state forever. Better than that, imagine you figured out how to use your sun, wind, and water to actually become a net producer of energy. And imagine if your land trust was so connected to the community that you set aside one tract of forest land all the time on which to grow firewood for low-income townspeople. Imagine that you'd work together with NOFA and the Farm Bureau to figure out how much land would be needed to produce a third of all the food you eat in the state. Imagine if every kid growing up in New Hampshire went to a great public school that got them outside, gave them space to build forts and make it common knowledge when the robins were going to return and when the sap was flowing and right now, what phase of the moon we're in. And imagine that every logger, fisherman, carpenter in this state knew that their kid had the option of doing the same work if they wanted to, because the forest was healthy, the community was healthy, and that work was respected. So I think it's efforts like that are going to keep conservation alive 200 years from now, 500 years from now. And what's really powerful to me is I see efforts by land trusts here in New Hampshire to make new allies and to listen to their community. And those efforts is just what Ryan said, they're transformative. I showed you a picture before of Classy Parker, and here she is again. And I did that because she's one of the people in my life as a conservationist who helped me to stretch my thinking about what conservation means to different people. And I will always bow, Roger, bow gratitude to TPL for enabling me to meet Classy and work with her when we were creating the urban gardens in New York City. Who might this person be for you in your community? Connecting with Classy for me, even though I was born in Brooklyn, you know, I had never met anyone like her. And I had never met anyone who was so deeply connected to a piece of land as she was in any city. For Jean, Temi, and Swansea was Mike Johnson. your old-timer farmer with lots of skills and abilities who Gene connected with and came to respect a great deal. I could feel and hear Mike's influence on Gene when she said to me, and I'm quoting, "If people feel connected, they're going to protect the land without anyone telling them to do it." Gene calls her way of building new allies backdoor conservation. Because neighbors who trust one another, they use the back door or the kitchen door. They don't use the front door. Carl Wallman in Pittsfield calls it, and I'm quoting here, "working together across stone walls." And for Ryan, it's about getting the widest possible cast of characters carrying conservation in their own way, using their own tools. And what results from finding new allies is the possibility for much bigger, more successful work, because we don't have to do it all on our own anymore. Ken Chu, who works on mental health issues in Keene, asks, and this is a really, really provocative question, I'm quoting here, "what's your land trust role in improving children's emotional health?" He says, he goes on to say, "this sounds so grandiose and unanswerable and off your mission, but it can actually be answered yes if you find the right partners. Let us work with you," Ken says. So community conservation is about finding a role you can feel good about in helping your community. For the Upper Valley Land Trust, that meant working with ADA requirements to help people with mobility difficulties to get out on the land. So take this in. That means the Upper Valley Land Trust is allowing people to use ATVs on their land, which it's been a while since I was in New Hampshire, but I have a feeling that might not be always be the most popular thing. Pete Helm said to me, and this is a really, really important question, he said, "if you were disabled, Peter, wouldn't you want this?" Yes, I would. Absolutely. Yes, I would. And to say yes shows that we have empathy, that we care about what someone else cares about, not just what we care about, and that's what's going to hold conservation together for us. For Pete Helm, it's absolutely all about relationship. He said to me, "yes, we've definitely got to hold the line for good soils and healthy wetlands and healthy forests, but we've also got to learn not to take down the small treehouse at the edge of the forest. We've got to want kids to play. Who else is going to sustain conservation in the long term?" By now, you've all heard about these two, right? The oxen that have come to symbolize Swansea. So I want to ask you, what does a pair of oxen have to do with land conservation? Well, it turns out quite a lot. They mean something very, very significant to people there enough for them to vote for conservation and donate easements over their land and to bring together very, very different bedfellows. It's really easy, it's very easy in a professional crowd to diminish that symbol of the oxen, and you can call it quaint or simplistic or small scale, and that misses the point that it's been successful. They found a practical and a real way to connect conservation to a significant percentage of a population. How many of us can say we've done that? Is this the only way in New Hampshire that conservation can look? If it can look different, if it can look like this, or this, or even this, that's how we'll help conservation grow. All of these boil down to one thing, I think. Being able to listen to a real diversity of voices and listen, not sell. When you own or control a third of the state, the graceful thing to do is to listen a great deal. And I think great community conservation is about listening. About listening to hear what a community needs and finding the sweet spot between what you do really well and what that community needs, where there is an overlap there. Here's one approach. I believe deeply in conservation. I have a conservation plan that's going to enrich your life. Allow me to try to convince you of what I believe in. And here's the alternative. What do you believe in and need? How can what I do well fulfill what you care about? Let's do this together. So often we end up saying no to things, right? And that's a very, very hard thing. Ryan Owens asks all of us to reevaluate your opposition, your response to opposition. Don't assume that more of the same is going to be your salvation. Or if I can only explain myself better, I will win the argument. Whenever we go in to educate, no matter how positive the interaction, we make someone else feel uneducated, end quote. Rob Riley of the Northern Forest Center told me, when we take the time to hear the community's needs first, they'll often turn to conservation on their own. But no one likes being sold something. In Coos County, no one's going to say yes to more federal money for land acquisition, but they are going to say yes to a community forest. What's working really well is meeting people on their own turf. Leaving your assumptions at the door about what they want and what you need, being open to new ground being discovered, thinking about the relationship, not just the transaction, and honoring the other side. We're making, I think, really, really good progress as a community of conservationists. But what worries me is a reliance on a set of tools that are so much more about the power of the stick than the sweet taste of the carrot, and all the different ways that we've learned to say no, as that slide presented before. We're not going to make progress that we need to make by just being against things, and things that are important to people, like houses. I live in a house. I bet most of you live in a house. We have to be for things to really make progress. And we have to tell a story that others in New Hampshire can clearly see themselves within. And it needs to be a story that excites and draws them in. Ryan told me, paper-based parcel-by-parcel conservation isn't going to be enough. You can't do it fast enough. We don't have enough money. The current ethic of faster and faster, more and more, may be counterproductive, he said. We need a new story, end quote. And I really, really agree. Transactions alone aren't going to get us to that vision. And I know how scary that is, especially to a community of professionals like yourselves that have been so well trained and so good at doing the deals. If I'm not negotiating a conservation easement, then what am I doing? Maybe the place to start is really, really simple. I think it is. It's regularly sitting down with someone we're a little bit afraid of and asking them to have a cup of coffee. Ask them what they care about and how we can help. And the core of what I'm talking about is the simple effort of helping very different people to take their best step toward each other. And conservation, I'll take a stand for that. I think conservation has a big role in that. I believe more than ever in what you do. Providing people with the relationship to land and nature, it's still medicine for what most ails us here in New Hampshire and everywhere else. Our healthy relationship to the land is the means by which we generate and recreate all the transcendent, all the really big values that are important to us, like love and beauty and responsibility. These things make a nation, and they make a state. I want you to think of that letter that Bill wrote to his family when he was 25 years old, and consider, again, what would you take a stand for? You may be really surprised, as I have been surprised all throughout my life as a conservationist, to learn that there are others who share my feelings, though they do not look like me, and they do not use the words that I use. And there are many, many thousands of New Hampshire folks who love the land and may now be or forever have been at the edge of town or mainstream culture. If they're there by choice or not, I don't know, but they often feel strangers in their own community, left out of economic progress for whatever reasons. Folks sometimes who are here first or folks who came last. People who work with their hands in a world now that works entirely with their heads, or folks simply on the losing end of a demographic trend. It's not that I hope to do conservation just for them, or I ask you to do conservation just for them. But I will not do conservation that forgets them. And to do so would be to forget my father. So I don't know the answers at all, but I do know what the answers sound a little bit like. Amanusit, Asati, Androscoggin, Pemajawasit, Musalak, Kentukuk, Carrigan, Haystack, Canterbury, Mahusit, Dunghill, Galehead, The Horn, Mariah, Beans Grand, Tenny, Moose, and Ragsend. Shakers, Bethlehem, Coos, Pankamangus, Monadnock, Bear Paw. Thank you so much for all you do.